Allstate has new lower auto rates. Nope. Allstate has new low.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
Well, good morning. It's good to see everybody out this morning. Glad you've decided to come and worship here with us at Cedar Hill Baptist Church, and glad you are here today, and appreciate you keeping the social distancing away from everybody else. Appreciate you abiding by those guidelines that we're still going by. Just want to welcome everybody. If we do have visitors today, I just want you to do one thing for me, and that is to fill out the visitor's card that's located right there in the seat in front of you, just to pick that up. Fill that out. You can put that in the offering plate when it comes by, or not when it comes by, but at the end of the service, you can put it at the doors, and you can have that. And the reason I do that, I want you to know this, is that that just gives me a record of who was here, but also want to let you know that that I just keep that on my desk, and I want you to know that I pray for you throughout the week. And so I just like to have that. It helps me put a name with a face, but I also want to let you know that I pray for you and pray for your family throughout the weeks. Just want to remind you, the plan as of now, with this ever-changing world that we're living in right now, the plan of as of right now, we will be back full force June 7th, okay? That means here at the church, full force June 7th here at the church. And that means that our plan right now is to start everything up the first Sunday of June. So that's the plan as of right now. Also, just want to mention to you, just remember that today is Pastor Ronnie's birthday. You'll be hearing a little bit more about that here in a second. But also, if you get a chance, just send him a text. I think text message might be the best way to communicate with him right now, to let him know that you're just wishing him a happy birthday. So, Pastor, if you're watching, we just want to say to you, happy birthday. We love you, and I hope you get to feeling better. There's some clapping for you. I hope you can hear that. If he's watching live today, I hope he can hear that. But anyway, this is our intercessory prayer time, and just want everyone just to bow their head this morning before we go into worship. Just want to get us into a place of worship. I want our mindset to be at a place for worship. So I just want you to bow your head this morning. Maybe there's something that you need to just deal with the Lord about. Maybe there's something that you just need to say, Lord, I need you to take this off my chest today, where God, you can just minister to me. I want you to get to a place right now where you can worship the Lord. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for the opportunity that we have to just to gather in your house and to worship you. Lord, I pray that we will put our focus on you, either here in this worship service in the sanctuary, Lord, on social media, wherever we are, on Facebook, YouTube, whatever the avenue is that we're using to follow you this morning. God, I pray that we will, Lord, just put our focus on you. God, I pray today that you will come and meet with us. Lord, I pray that today is a good day to be in the house of the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Brother Eric.
Good morning. Oh, y'all can do better than that. Good morning. There you go. If you would please stand, join me in singing the song Forever.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. His love endures forever, for the life that's been reborn. His love endures forever, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever, forever. From the rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever. By the grace of God we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Forever God is faithful. Forever.
Y'all can be seated. Good morning. Glad to see everybody here. I just wanted to, Dad called. He was planning on being here today, but just couldn't make it. But all y'all's cards he got, and today is his birthday. But he just wanted me to get up here and tell y'all thank you for just everything. Brian and I were talking, I guess, a couple weeks ago. And we were just talking about Cedar Hill, and Dad's ministry here, and he's ministered here for 30 years, and these past 5 years have been pretty rough physically on him, and it's just a blessing more than you all will ever know. To see how the church ministers back to him. And so I just want to thank y'all from the bottom of my heart, because again, I've never been a part of any other church as I have here, and I'm thankful for that. am blessed to say that. So I don't know how other churches work, but I just want to tell you, Dad, like I said, he's ministered here for so many years, and just to see how you all pick up the mantle and pour all of that back into him, and as he's laying in bed and kind of has tough days where he has hard time getting up and getting around. Sorry. Again, y'all are just a blessing, and you encourage him more than you know, all these cards and everything. So from the bottom of my heart and my family's heart, thank y'all for being a godly family that we could we couldn't even ask for. He's truly blessed us. So let me thank God for y'all real quick. Dearly Father, I just I thank you for all your many blessings, Lord, and I thank you for allowing us to be back in your house and worshiping you together, Lord. And Lord, most of all, I just thank you for Dad. It's his birthday today. I thank you for the lessons he's taught me here on this corner, and not only through him, but all these people that you've brought alongside to encourage him. Lord, I thank you for this church, and I pray that we can continue just to follow your guidance in ministering to this community. Lord, I just ask that your hand be over this service, be with Brother Brian as he brings your message. And it's in your name I pray. Amen.
Thank you for that update, Troy. Pastor, just want to say, if you are watching this morning, I pray that I don't put you to sleep in that bed, okay? But anyway, I let me say this before we move any further. I do know how other churches operate. And let me say this, and I'm bragging on you as a church, just being here for 5 months now. Hard to believe. Time flies when you're having fun, right? Amen? Amen. Road shows with Brian, we'll go anywhere, okay? But anyway, let me say this. I do know how other churches operate, and I would say this. And I told Troy that day. We were out ministering to a family that pastor wanted us to minister to. And so we were walking around, and I will say this. Most of the time, 9 times out of 10, just like I told Troy that day, 9 times out of 10, most churches would have kicked Brother Ronnie to the curb. That's just how they operate. I've seen the good, bad, and ugly in churches, and it's one thing that really I think that lured me into Cedar Hill is to see that you honor the position of the pastor. You honor that position, and you make sure that you give them the authority that they deserve. And I want to say thank you, Cedar Hill, for just being who you are. And honoring the position, not the person, but it's not talking about just honoring the person. This is about you honoring the position and the authority of that pastor position. That's the most important thing. And so I want to commend you, and I want you to give yourself a round of applause just for being who you are. I know that I know things look different, okay? I know things look different right now than what it did 30 years ago when he came to this corner, this hill on this corner as he talks about it. But let me tell you something. I'm here to tell you this, that the same God that was here 30 years ago on this corner, he's the same God that is here today, all right? Amen? Everybody say that, all right? Amen. I want you to believe that, okay? He's still the same God. And we're going to continue moving forward, and we're going to do what God wants us to do. We're going to remain faithful. We're going to be the church that God wants us to be. And so this morning, with saying all that, I want you to put our focus back where it needs to be on God's Word. And I want you to take your Bibles and turn with the book of Luke. Luke chapter 2, it's going to be on the screen as well, I believe. And Luke chapter 2. Now, some of you this morning might be the first time that you've been back in church since we've had this coronavirus scare, okay? But I do want to talk to you about the title. I've entitled this message, Let's Retrace Our Steps. Let's retrace our steps. Now, some of us, this might be the first time that we have let me back this up. Maybe we left Christ in the pew with us when we left a month and a half ago, and we hadn't even thought about Christ. We haven't had our quiet time. We hadn't had our prayer time. And many of us today might have left Jesus in that pew a month and a half ago, right where we are seated today. Where is Jesus? He's right where you left him. Today, if you're wavering in your faith, I want you to retrace your steps, and I want you to think back to where Christ was the sweetest he was to you. I want you to retrace your steps this morning. I want to read a story to you that's very familiar to you in God's Word, that we see that Mary and Joseph, the mother and father of Jesus, he had to retrace his steps. They had to retrace their steps in finding Jesus. Let's give reverence to God's Word. Let's stand for the ones that are able to stand, for the ones that want to stand. We respect all stances of reading, if you don't want to, but if you want to stand, I want to encourage you to do that. Luke chapter 2, verse number 41. Let's give reverence to God's Word as it states, "His parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem according to the customs of the feast. When they had finished the days as they returned, the boy Jesus lingered behind in Jerusalem, and Joseph and his mother did not know it. But supposing him to have been in the company, they went a day's journey and sought him among their relatives and acquaintances. So when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem, seeking him. Now so it was that after 3 days they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the teachers, both listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers. So when they saw him, they were amazed, and his mother said to him, 'Son, why have you done this to us? Look, your father and I have sought you anxiously.' And he said to them, 'Why do you seek me? Did you not know that I must be about my father's business?' But they did not understand the statement which he spoke to them." May God bless the reading of His Word. You may be seated. I want to ask you a couple of questions this morning. I need your help, okay? Because I need you to raise your hand, and I want some of you to tell the truth, okay? Well, I want all of you to tell the truth, not just some of you. But how many of you are good at misplacing things? Okay, some of you. Chelsea's out there trying to get the baby to sleep. I know she wants to answer for me. But I'm very good at it. It might be right up under me, but Eric, are you good at misplacing things? Oh, yeah, he said. Yeah. Eric says he's good at misplacing things as well. But how many of you, when you misplace something, you go through the process of backtracking where we lost saw that? Have you ever done that? How many of you do that as well? That when you misplace something, you're like, okay, the last time I saw it was here. Pacifiers. We probably have 50,000 pacifiers in the house. And we can't keep up with them. I don't know where that boy puts them. And I'm like, okay, it was on the changing table. It was on the bed. Chelsea, have you seen the pacifier? We misplace things, and we have to backtrack when we cannot find them. One thing that I misplace a lot of is this right here, my cell phone. I misplace it a lot. But the great thing about it is, listen, Apple has me right where they want me. I drank the Kool-Aid. Listen, I have an Apple Watch on my hand right here. I have an Apple phone. I preach off an iPad. I have a Mac in my office. I have 2 Apple laptops. I mean, they got me where they want me. I mean, I drank the Kool-Aid. But the great thing about wearing an Apple Watch is that they have this button. Matt, go ahead and put this on the screen. How many of you have an Apple Watch this morning? Some of you? Okay. Boy, let me tell you something. You need to go get you one. These are the greatest things ever. Now look, when I misplace this, maybe you can hear it this morning. I'm going to turn my sound on just for 1 second. But listen, sometimes when you misplace something, like my cell phone, Y'all have to listen real well. Y'all know what I'm fixing to do. I'm fixing to push that button right there on the screen on my watch and see what happens. Listen, y'all listen. Y'all hear that? So that when I misplace my cell phone somewhere in the house that I do, it can fall down in the recliner. It can go wherever, you know, I can misplace it, leave it up in the bedroom. And the beautiful thing about it is I got a kid now that thinks it's a game. Hannah, see if you can find that sound. Hannah, see if you can do it. I can stay in the recliner and Hannah can, do it again, Daddy. Bing, 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 bing. Do it again, Daddy. Bing, 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 bing. Oh, I found it, here it is. Well, good, you did so good. But we have to retrace these steps sometimes, and it's a great thing. I mean, I'm good at misplacing things, but thanks be to God that Apple has really solved my problem in a sense. Now, the reason that I tell you this, and the reason that we misplace things in our life, stay with me this morning before we get in our scripture text. Stay with me. But the reason that we misplace things is because we become careless and our focus shifts away from certain things onto something else. The reason that I misplaced this cell phone is because sometimes it falls down in right in the seat of the couch or the seat of the recliner. Is that there might be a football game on and Auburn's beating Tennessee. Okay, some of y'all are still awake this morning. Some of you, in your dreams over here, so I got some that are staying with. But, you know, it might fall down. But the reason that I've misplaced it is that my focus has shifted away from where the cell phone is to that football game. And, you know, sometimes that's how we misplace things, is our focus, it shifts away from where it should be, and our concentration goes on something else than where it should be in certain situations. Now, that's what we do sometimes in our Christian life. Our focus shifts away from the Lord sometimes because we are influenced by other things instead of Him. Maybe this last month and a half, your focus has shifted, could have easily shifted away from Christ, and it could have focused in on something else. In our text today, we're reminded how easy it is to leave Christ behind. Jesus' parents, they didn't mean to leave Christ behind, but they were influenced by others that were around them, and in return, their focus shifted away from the Lord. Their most prized possession was the Lord, and their focus shifted away from this most prized possession onto something else. It's so easy for our focus to shift away from the Lord and to go on to something else. And in return, the parents of Christ had to retrace their steps and see what caused them to misplace Jesus. Today, maybe you're at this point in your life. Maybe today, if you're still watching us through Facebook, that you're at this point of your life that you know that you've misplaced Jesus. It's time to get things back. It's time to get things back in order. It's time for me to take the right steps to go back and to find Christ where He was. I pray that if you have allowed other influences and influencers to come into your life and to make you and have allowed you to misplace Jesus, I pray today before we leave here that you will return to Him. And I pray through this story that I want to share with you that you can find Jesus and you can see Him by just retracing your steps. This morning, I want you to notice three reasons why we have to retrace our steps. And why it's so important. They're there on your screen. You can jot them down if you want to. But the first one that I want us to look at this morning is sometimes we are unaware we leave Jesus behind. Sometimes we are. We are unaware that we leave Jesus behind. We see this in verse number 44. He tells us in verse 44, it starts out, Luke tells it, his story of this. He says, but supposing him to have been in the company. We're going to wear out that phrase, but supposing, this morning. We're going to wear it out. Sometimes we are unaware that we leave Jesus behind just because we're supposing. Well, I suppose that this is going to happen. You see, this term means to rely on something that is not concrete or factual. So if we put this in the original language, we can say that the parents of Jesus were relying on something that was not concrete and that it was not factual. How many of us have a trouble putting our trust in the things that are factual. I don't want to see by a show of hands this morning, because I'll be the first one to tell you that I follow into this category. How many of you see a story on Facebook and it's like reading the National Enquirer? I'll just be honest with you. Those newspapers we can have when we check out the grocery store, there's not much truth in them. But you know, we look at it and you know, we're like, oh, no way. Okay, none of you are like that, just me. Y'all pray for me, okay? As I get better in this in my life. But the thing is, guys, it's very clear to me. It's but supposing. I'm just looking and saying, and you know, that's true. But no, it's not true. But supposing. The parents of Jesus were trusting in something. They were putting their faith and putting their trust in something that was not concrete and it was not factual. And sometimes when we do that, when it comes to our Christian life, when we put our trust in something that is not concrete and it's not factual, and we're basing everything on emotions instead of Jesus Christ and His Word, let me tell you something. It's going to lead you down a wrong path. You're going to end up leaving Jesus behind. They didn't mean to. You see, sometimes we're unaware that we leave Jesus behind. But supposing. It goes against God's Word. Everybody knows what Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Some of my favorite verses in all of God's Word is Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. He tells us in Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, God's Word says, "Trust in the Lord with all our heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your path." But supposing is going against Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. We are unaware sometimes that we leave Christ behind. So the question is this morning, how are we unaware that we leave Jesus behind? How are we unaware sometimes? Well, I hate to break it to you, but sometimes it's because the company that we are with, the company that we're surrounded, influences us to make us keep Jesus behind. Verse number 44 shows us this. But supposing to have been in the company, they went a day's journey and sought Him among their relatives and acquaintances. You see, you have to understand the background of verse number 44. The reason that we become unaware sometimes is because of the company that we're around. You see, this time of year was the Feast of Passover. And every devout Jew knew that it was mandatory to go up to Jerusalem during this time. And it lasted for a whole week. It lasted for 7 days. And many times extended families, as we read in our text, they go and they travel with one another. So Mary and Joseph probably thought that Jesus was with some cousins or with some aunts and uncles or something. You see, sometimes the company that we are with can hinder us from staying focused on the most prized possession. Is there anything wrong with hanging out with family? Heavens no, I love family. Is there anything wrong with having friends? Heavens no, I love having friends. I love having a good time. But we got to be careful that are they hindering us from misplacing Jesus? How this relates to us is, even though the company with us might not hinder us from staying focused on Christ, we need to know that no matter what our excuse is, it is our responsibility as a Christian to remain focused on Christ no matter what. Guys, that's one reason that we started this devotion on Facebook every morning. The reason that we started a month and a half ago, me and Pastor was brainstorming one day, how can we stay connected to our church during this disconnecting time? And I said, I would love to be able to do a devotion every day. Little did I know that what it was going to end up doing. And the thing is that, guys, we have tried our best as a church, as the best way possible, sharing stuff on Wednesday night, putting a blog up on our website on Wednesday night where you can see a Wednesday night Bible study. So we have to be careful that we are focusing on God. And no matter who our company is, no matter what our surroundings look like, it is our responsibility to take the right steps and do the right things to make sure that we stay faithful to God. That's what I believe that Luke is trying to get us to see in our scripture text this morning with that key phrase, but supposing. But not only do we see that it's the company that we with, that it sometimes it hinders our, keeps us from being unaware. But the second thing I notice in this text with me, also in verse number 44, is the commotion. It's the commotion that surrounds us. We become unaware because of the company that we're with, but also with the commotion that's around with the company that we're with. Let me ask you a question. I told you I needed a lot of help today. I need some more help. How many of you, when you gather with your extended family, it's mass chaos? Or it's just crazy? Okay, some of y'all. Man, y'all need to come hang out with my folks some. Y'all are laughing, you just don't want to raise your hand. Shame, shame. No, let's just think about it for a second. It's mass chaos, or I know it is around my crazy family. Or around Chelsea's crazy family. Let me tell you a story about Chelsea's crazy family when I first came into the family. Now I'm not chasing a rabbit. This ties into my text, okay? So y'all stay with me. Is that our Chelsea's family, every Labor Day, they have a big Lot family reunion. Lot is their last name, and man, it has been big over the years. Her mother, Chelsea's mother, said, "Brian, it's a lot easier than when I got in the family." I said, "What do you mean?" She said, "When all the cousins would get together, they wouldn't play flag football. They'd play tackle football." I think the first year that she went to the family reunion, they doused her with water. I mean, it's crazy stuff. And so I was like, well, thank God I missed the tackle football game with the family. I don't want to get a broken leg or anything of the first family get together. But the thing is, there's commotion that surrounds us. And if we read verse number 44, we see, let's just be honest, that when we were friends and we were family, we're having a good time. And the thing is that if we look at this, everybody is laughing. Everybody is having a good time. I believe in verse number 44, kids are running around. They're having a good time. And I believe, as Pastor Ronnie would say, there's probably even some intense fellowship that's going on during this time together. But there's commotion. You see, the reality is that there's a lot of commotion that's going on. And it's hard to stay focused when there's commotion going on, right? Am I right? It's hard. Sometimes it's hard. But how this relates to us is that we can lose contact. Stay with me. We can lose contact on the most important things in our life when we're around some of the most important people in our life, right? It's hard to lose focus. Sometimes we lose focus on the most important thing when we're around some of the most important people in our life. The main thing that we have to understand is no matter what we have, no matter what we do, we have to stay focused. And verse 44, instead of saying, "but supposing," we have to put it in concrete, factual information. Sometimes we're unaware that we lose Christ because of the company and the commotion that we're around, but sometimes we are out of touch with Jesus because we leave Him behind. You see what verse 43 and verse 44, notice that with me. It goes on to say that in verse 43 and 44, that the boy lingered behind. Now, this term, "boy lingered behind," means to endure something when others have departed. If you look at the original language, it's tough. It's tough to understand it. But if we see that it really takes on a totally different meaning, that it means that to endure. So the boy lingered behind. It means that he departed when others, he stayed when others departed. Sometimes we're out of touch with the Lord because we're not willing to endure. Let's be honest. The reason that we're out of touch with Christ sometimes is because we're not willing to endure. We're not willing to continue. The easiest thing is to give up. The easiest thing is to give up. How many of us here this morning have given up on the Lord because when we had to endure, we decided it's time for me to leave and go somewhere else? Endure this morning. Don't give up. But how do we get out of touch with the Lord? Brian, how is it so easy to get out of touch with the Lord? I believe that if we look at the scripture text, we can see how easy it is. Did you notice the first thing? It's destinations. We have things on our life. Now listen, stay with me as well this morning. I'm telling you, don't show a show of hands, okay? On this one. But I want you, how many of you have somewhere you need to go after church today? Don't raise your hand. I just want you to think about it. How many of you got plans? As soon as Brian hushes, I'm hitting the lake. As soon as Brian hushes, I'm hitting the golf course. As soon as Brian hushes, I'm going to Gatlinburg. I'm going to Knoxville. Going to Walmart. As soon as Brian hushes, I'm going to cut grass. Don't cut grass on Sunday, just my opinion. Because we can become out of touch with God because of destinations. We can become out of touch with God. And guys, your mind might be somewhere totally different this morning, and you're in the process of leaving God, Christ, in the pew that you left Him in a month and a half ago, that when we were having church. And guys, you're in the process of leaving Him there once again this morning if you're not careful, because of destinations, but also deadlines. Destination, I got to get somewhere. I got to get somewhere. That's why we have the intercessory prayer time. It's for us to clear our mindset, to clear our thought process, where we can focus in on God just for an hour. Give Him an hour. Give Him 45 minutes. We become out of touch with God because of destinations, but also deadlines. Verse 43, it says that, listen, I believe that one reason that the parents got out of touch with God, with Christ, is because they returned. Verse 43 tells us that. When they had finished, they returned. Maybe Christ is telling us to endure this morning as He did, instead of departing. Maybe Christ is telling us to endure when others are leaving. Listen, let me tell you something. You want me to tell you where how Cedar Hill's going to become the church that God wants us to be, and where God wants us to go, and maybe the church that it was maybe 15 years ago? It's going to take people. It doesn't matter who stands here. Listen to me this morning. It's going to take people enduring, lingering behind when others jump ship. You got to be faithful. Destinations and deadlines will get us out of touch with God. He tells that destinations, they returned. They were focused on going back home. See the deadlines as well. It says, when they had finished, deadlines. Listen, we're done. We're gone. Verse number 43 tells us that. It says, when they had finished, they returned, and the boy lingered behind in Jerusalem. And mother and his parents didn't know where he was. They had done their religious duties. It was time that they go back home. Destinations and deadlines can hinder us from and make us become out of touch with the Lord. Sometimes we're unaware we leave Jesus behind. Sometimes we are out of touch with Jesus when we leave Him behind. But then the last thing, and then we're closing this morning, is sometimes we are misinformed and we leave Jesus behind. Misinformed and we leave Jesus behind. Look at verse 48. It says, so when they saw Him, they were amazed. And His mother said to Him, son, why have You done this to us? Look, Your father and I have sought You anxiously. How many of you, you can raise your hand for this one, okay? How many of you have ever been misinformed in your life? Or, let's see if we can get all the hands up. How many of you have ever been lied to? Okay. I knew I could get all the hands up before the end of the service. But sometimes we are misinformed and we leave Jesus behind. I don't think that they lied to Him. I don't think that the company that they were with, friends and family, folks that they loved the most, I don't think they lied to them in person, but they were just like, have you seen Jesus? Eric, have you seen Jesus? You know, have you seen, Kay, have you seen Jesus? Greg, have you seen Jesus? Gene, have you seen Jesus? I think they're just going through the company that they're with, and they're asking, and they're like, no, I hadn't seen him. No, I don't know. I don't. Rodney, have you seen Jesus? You know, I think that's what they're doing. They're just walking through. Chris, have you seen Jesus? I mean, I think that's what God's doing. And guys, I think that they're, he was back there with Uncle So-and-so. You know they're always lingering behind. You know you shouldn't leave your kids with them. You know, that maybe that's the kind of thing. Let's be honest. That's how family is sometimes when we're there, but it can misinform us. And I believe that because of what we read in the other verses of this is that, look, it says in verse 45, so when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem seeking him. As we see also that it was a day's journey. So they spent a day not knowing where Jesus was, asking around the family, and I believe that they were just misinformed. Surely he didn't stay back. So what happens, guys, when we're misinformed sometimes? And we have to retrace our steps. Sometimes when we're misinformed, we have to return searching for answers. When we're misinformed, we have to retrace our steps, don't we? And we have to return to the source, and we have to find the answer. In verse number 46, it shows us that, so it was after how many days? 3 days they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the teachers, both listening to them and asking them questions. You see, sometimes we are misinformed and we leave Jesus behind. I believe that they were misinformed and it took them 3 days to find Jesus. So what happens when we're misinformed? When we return searching for answers, guys, listen, you can find Jesus. You have to return this morning. Maybe you're on the cusp. Maybe today you need salvation. Maybe you sit in church and you got everybody fooled here this morning. And maybe they might even think that you're a church member. And you never even joined the church. You're misinformed. But when you return and you search for answers and you find answers, listen, God can bless you. Maybe today needs to be the day of salvation for someone. Maybe today you've been misinformed all these years and you don't know what Jesus, you really don't have that relationship with Christ. Maybe you have everybody fooled, but you've misinformed. You've been misinformed, but today can be the day of salvation for you. The only way when we're misinformed that we can be informed is that we have to return searching for answers. Maybe today just needs to be the day of rededication. You can say, Brian, look, I left Jesus here. Maybe I left him here 10 years ago. Maybe there's been something that's happened and you've left Jesus in that pew 10 years ago. And you're saying, Brian, it's petty. It's petty. It's not a big deal. And Brian, it's none of your business. Praise God. But Brian, I need to return to Jesus this morning. I'm ready, Brian, just to pick him up out of this pew. I left him here 5, 6, 10 years ago. But Brian, I'm ready to return to Jesus. I'm ready to return to the temple and to find him. And the only way that you can do that when you're misinformed is that you search for answers. Are you willing to search for answers this morning? We have to return searching for answers, but also you have to return to the source for answers. Did you see where the source was? Look in verse 46. See if you can find it for me in verse 46. Now it was, after 3 days, they found him where? In the temple. Let me tell you where you're going to find the answers of Christ is here. In his word, in his house, among fellowship with others. You have to return to the source for answers. But I love how verse 49, I love how Christ, did you notice during this whole dialogue, during this story, even though that he was gone, did you notice how he talked? The first thing out of his mouth was, it's in verse 49. Notice it with me, then we're closing. You have to return to the source for answers. Guys, when you make the choice to return to the source for answers, Jesus Christ is going to speak to you. He's not going to leave you hanging. He's always going to be there for you. Did you notice what he said? He said, "Why did you seek me? Did you not know that I must be about my Father's business?" Guys, here at Cedar Hill Baptist Church, we must be about our Father's business. Have you left Christ in the pew? Maybe you've left him, maybe not in the church house, but you know at a certain situation that you've left him there. Physically, you don't need to return there, but spiritually, you need to return there this morning. Are you willing to return for the right source of answers? Guys, we think that Christ sometimes and the answers are all in the big things and the lights and all of that. Sometimes Christ, just like he did Elijah, is that Christ, he offers and he talks to us in that still, small voice. It's in the little things. It's in the little things. Years ago, there was a story of a man by the name of Douglas Meyer. He was 15 years old, and he lived in Missouri. Creve Coeur, Missouri. And he had been feeling bad for several days. His temperature was ranging from 103 to 105 degrees. His family thought that he was suffering from flu-like symptoms. Finally, his mother, he took him to St. Louis to the nearest big doctor, and he found out that Douglas Meyer was diagnosed with leukemia. Upon learning that, he went into this deep, deep, dark depression. Knowing that he went into a deep, dark depression, he had an aunt. They called the local floral shop, and he sent Douglas an arrangement of flowers that she told the clerk that it was her teenage nephew who had just found out that he had leukemia. When the flowers arrived at the hospital, they were beautiful. Douglas read the card from his aunt, but there he saw a second card as well. It said this, it said, "Douglas, I took your order. I work at the floral shop. I had leukemia when I was 7 years old. Today I'm 22 years old. Good luck. My heart goes out to you. Sincerely, Laura Bradley." His face lit up. And a 15-year-old said this. He said, "Oh, it's funny that I'm filled in a room with millions of dollars and sophisticated medical equipment that he was being treated by with expert doctors and nurses that had medical training that was over hundreds of years put together. But it was the salesperson in a flower shop that was making $170 a week who by taking time and care and being willing to go with what her heart told her, gave Douglas hope and the will to carry on." This morning, in closing, where are you looking for answers? Are you trying to find Jesus in all the big things and the glamour and the big places? Have you misplaced Jesus Christ because you have looked for him in all the wrong places? Maybe, just maybe this morning, he can be found in that seat that you're sitting in. I pray that if you found him this morning, I pray that if you need salvation today, if you need to join the church, if you've been coming for years, but you need to join the church, I pray that you will not allow the devil to keep you in your seat this morning telling you that it's because of social distancing and the CDC and the coronavirus that you can't come forward. I pray today that you will put all that fear out of the side and you will come and you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, that you will come and rededicate your life. you need to join the church, I pray that you'll come this morning. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your word today. God, I pray that people will be obedient to what you're telling them to do right now. God, have they misplaced you? Do they know that they've left you in the pew years ago? Do they know that they need to return to you? God, I pray that they will. Lord, I pray that nothing will hinder us from taking that step out of the pew, coming to know you as our personal Lord and Savior. And God, that you get all the glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Eric, what hymn are we singing this morning?